thank you very much for coming. And first of all, I would like to thank you for the organization, but also NAFA for the organization and invitation. But first of all, I have to say that when I looked at the title, it was called the between digital and political, the ecologies of the mind. And then I have not to say about the political and the digital, but I have very little to say about ecologies of the mind. So what I have done is that I looked into the thing that I have written in the past 10 years, just to find what can I say about the ecologies of the mind. And then I find out this, I decided to talk about the concept of tertiary potential, which may be new for many people, including philosophers who are not familiar with the work of Husserl and Derrida. So this will be a little bit technical, what I'm going to say, but I'll try my best to explain and to show why it is a philosophical and technological question that we have to pose today. But before I start, I would like to connect it to the talks of David, because otherwise we find there's completely no relation between the two. I would like to simply make a relation here. I think what David was talking about and what is central to the concept of organism as opposed to mechanism is what in cybernetics is called feedback. But what is a feedback? We can have different levels of feedback, and if you are familiar with the work of Bateson says, for him, there's two. He did one example about two understanding of feedback with a difference. One is, for example, when you're shooting a bird, and the bird is there, is standing there. So what you have to do is that you only need to move the position of the gun in order to shoot. But now if the bird is flying, what do you have to do? You have to coordinate the whole body. So this is a second, a different types of feedback. And if we look at the history of, for example, around the 30s, 40s, there are different disciplines coming up which have a quite similar idea, for example, the general system theory of data entry, autonomous theory, the theory of automata from Neumann, and then also cybernetics. This seems to develop independently, but what is in common is this idea of recursivity. So I would like to emphasize on the concept of recursivity, and because I believe that if you want to understand what is an algorithm today, and in order to deepen our understanding of the concept of digital, it is necessary to elaborate on the concept of recursivity. And it is on the concept around the concept of recursivity that I developed this concept of tertiary potential. And we know that today, if we talk about digitization, it's always about producing or recording traces, keeping traces that are produced by the users and so on and so forth. And here, what I try to do in this talk is I will suggest that in order to understand the political and technological question of the digital, it is necessary that we make a distinction from the philosophical inquiries in the 20th century, which is to say, to see technology as forms of writing, as retentions of traces. And so what I'm going to do in the remaining in this text, in this talk, is to have a review of what is of the philosophical concept or conceptualization of the question of technology, and how are we going to rethink of this movement today. So I start with the question of the archive, and also to think about the the future of the archive and the future of this question itself. And here I make a reference to Derrida, and I will also start with Derrida in order to explain, and I think I was told that everyone here has read a lot of Derrida, right? So that's probably a good starting point. But let me start with one of my personal experience. So this is a plan of the Pocket Folk. In 1985, when the newly formed College International de Philosophie met with the direction Direction des Archives de France of the Ministry of Culture, notably with the presence of some of its directors, including Jean-François Lyotard, Jacques Derrida, Bernard Stiegler, and Jacques Poncelet, among others, the question for discussion was how to rethink the future of archives. Especially it was the big beginning of digitization in 1985. So what they discuss is to rethink of the future of the archives, of the institutionalization, their use and the maintenance in light of the newly emerging forms of audiovisual technologies and practice. But 30 years later, this question is still fresh. So this is the askew fresh, not just because they have never been truly resolved, but because it has become increasingly urgent to reflect on them, given what has occurred since 1985. A massive process of digitization throughout every facet of society and driven by industrialization. This episode from the 20th century is involved in many of the most prominent thinkers of memory and technology, has largely been forgotten, even by Bernard Stiegler himself, who presented a test, this text, that I show here to the meeting co-authored with the philosopher Patrice Vermeulen. The text outlined questions to be approached, and it was addressed to the Ministry of Culture on behalf of the Collège International de Philosophie. This six-page document was found during my visit on the 1985 exhibition organized by Jean-François Lyotard, titled Les Immatériels, which I conducted at the archive of the Centre Georges Pompidou in Paris in 2014. The document had been placed in a folder categorized as the personal belongings of Jean-François Lyotard. Because Lyotard was the curator of this exhibition, but this document was clearly not part of this exhibition at all, so it has to be archived according to a relevance which remains unstated. So for example, personal belongings. Another copy of the same document may well be lying somewhere inside the College International de Philosophie archive, categorized and indexed in a completely different way. But this archive has anticipated my visit, because from the moment of its creation, it has presupposed a visit from future researchers working on this event. But in what way does it anticipate my visit? This is our question concerning the future of archives, as well as the question of tertiary potential, both the question of this future and the question of the future of this question. An archive is not just a relic from the past or some accumulation of outdated material, rather it opens a path to the past in a way that anticipates a future. The archive is in this way always the present, or better, it is a kind of against becoming. If we construe the etymology of the German word for present, Gegenwart, which is from Gegenwerden, it resists the no longer and the not yet. The archive is the totality of the present, the totality of relations that constantly modifies both the past and the future in every passing now. But in saying this, however, we remain within a phenomenological perspective, characteristic of the 20th century, understanding of the archive and history, itself conditioned by a specific retention of technology of paper and light and printing, but also analog technologies. Where in the years since, a new epoch in a phenomenological sense, which means suspension, has arrived with the advent of the epoch of digital technology, and in order to pursue a renewed understanding of the question of potential, we must revisit the encounter in the 20th century between phenomenology and deconstruction. In his 1994 lecture, later published as Archive of Freudian Impression, Jacques Derrida began by noting that the word archive comes from the Greek word arche, principle of the origin, and that this means both commencement and commandment, so both meanings. And it is the question of commencements rather than commandments that would occupy Derrida in this talk. A question that has been posed by a Jewish scholar, Haim Yahusami, in his book Freud's Gnosis, Judaism, Terminable and Interminable. The question is this: Is psychoanalysis a Jewish science? The quest after the origins from the preservation of the past is for Derrida an archive drive, which is another name for what he calls archive fever. It arises from out of a fear of finitude in the anticipation of mortality, of death. As Derrida puts it, I quote, "There would indeed be no archive desire without the radical finitude, without the possibility of a forgetfulness which doesn't limit itself to repression." End of quote. Derrida proposed here a new theory of the archive based on Freudian psychoanalysis. Throughout the lecture, Derrida explores how the question of the origin leads ultimately to the question of the future. In this instance, the future of Jewishness and that of science. The origin is always deferred, and within such a difference, which is found inside the archive itself, a future is opened up, as Derrida had already written in the earlier lecture, difference. I quote, "The problem of writing opens by questioning the archive," end quote. Difference, of course, is Derrida's famous neologism constructed through a twist of the orthography of the word difference in French with an E, but the word created by Derrida is with an A. Both words are in French pronounced identically, and the inaudible difference between them is visible only when they are written. Difference is for Derrida a known word and not a concept. It is rather a movement that disturbs and displaces what I would call archival metaphysics. As après tout, it is here worth noticing that the archive, when it is seen as a totality of truth, there's another name, metaphysics, or better, an archival metaphysics, in which state everything becomes a standing reserve in the sense of idea. To deconstruct the archive is to transform the question of the arche, of the archive, to see it as a question of the difference with A, within which temporalization and spatialization take place, and in such a way that the origin is no longer identifiable. Difference resembles the Heraclitian conflict or the Nietzschean force that actively seeks to disturb or invert the metaphysical event, a metaphysical system, as Derrida writes regarding difference. I quote, "We share therefore," here I also quote here in the slide, "we share therefore for difference is active in movement, this code of the different forces and of the differences between forces which Nietzsche opposes to the entire system of metaphysical grammar. Wherever the system controls culture, philosophy, and science." Archival metaphysics is deconstructed from within by the chasers that constitute its own corpus. This deferral finds its best expression in Freud's Nachteiligkeit, deferred action, which destabilizes any system of presence or of being. Archival metaphysics is everywhere and persists through the new technology of intersecticality and connection that constantly sets itself in tension with difference. In the new technological condition established up to the 20th century, that is to say the digital, we find that an ontological account of technology seems no longer sufficient to cope with the transformation of the archive. But in order to inform our argument, we must go back to what is crucial for both Derrida and later Stigler, another book has given talk here before, though in different ways, Husserl's time consciousness, also called genetic phenomenology, through this excursion into their readings, we will show how the archive is indeed a key philosophical question here. Now we come to the second part, the conflict of the orders of retention and protection. So I should have already said at the beginning, the retention is what is retained in memory, for example, the past, and potential is what is anticipated to come. And in different homes, after giving this lecture of Derrida, after giving critique of Saussure's theory of science, Derrida introduces the concept of archive writing, which is based on a play of the potential and retention of differences. I quote here, the use of language or the employment of any code which implies a play of forms, which no determined or invariable substratum also presupposes a retention and potential of differences, a spacing and temporalizing, a play of traces. This play must be a sort of inscription prior to writing, a proto writing without a person, origin, without an archive. From this comes the systematic crossing out of the archive and the transformation of general semiology into a grammatology. Now, what is it meant here by retention and potential of differences? In the early passage of the text, Derrida insists that his use of the term potential and retention are only, I quote, analogically and provisionally, a phenomenological and transcendental language that will presently be reviewed as inadequate, end quote. We will see later how this dialectics of retention and potential is inadequate, but we will also discover that this does not mean that these concepts are not useful, for it is indeed the play between the retention and the potential that constitutes the question of the archive. But these two terms, retention and potential, comes from Edmund Husserl, one referring to what is retained and the other to what is anticipated, and together with the present, they form what is known as triple intention narrative. Already in the 1904-05 process, Husserl attempts to provide a model of the genesis of time consciousness by introducing the play of these triple intentionalities. It is difficult to generalize a single theory of time consciousness or a definite relation between potential and retention in Husserl's work, since he went back to them in his later work known as the Banner Manuscript, 1917-1918, analysis of passive synthesis and the C manuscript. But it has to, maybe I should mention that actually Derrida, before he wrote his two major work on phenomenology, he didn't read the Banner Manuscript because it was in only discovered in the 1960s in the office of Eugen Fink. In these research articles, Husserl put forward a variation on the models concerning time consciousness, but we will only illustrate this with a simple example of a memory. So the memory is presented as a stream of consciousness. So we imagine there's a memory running through us, where every now passes into the already. So it's already passed. And it is added to the stock of retention, where every anticipate not yet becomes a noun and is thereby fulfilled before passing into retention. So every noun is retained, become past, and every anticipate become now. For Derrida, the play of retention and contention is the source of the construction of the metaphysics of presence, as you can see here. Since every consciousness of the now demands a delay, for example, the now B is constituted by the retention of the now A, which has passed, and the potential of now C, which is just anticipated. And there is indeed a play of non-presence conditions by Aki writing, which can never be reduced to any word or any concept such as retention or potential. The irreducibility of Aki writing, which involves proto chases, lies in the factor of difference. If in his lectures on time consciousness, Husserl has distinguished on the first level primary retention and potential, and on the second level recollection and anticipation, which Stigler later called secondary retention and potential. Derrida refuses to grant the absoluteness to any such distinction on the ground that the difference between potential and retention are only differences of degree. So I have to emphasize on this point because, for example, when I listen to a melody now, what I retain every now that pass by and anticipate the what is coming, but tomorrow I can remember what I have heard today. So this is no longer the primary retention and primary retention, but they are the secondary retention. These are memory. And when I'm listening to the melody again, I can remember what is when I start singing myself, I can already anticipate the next melody, for example. So this is the secondary potential. But Derrida refused that there is such a difference. Derrida refused that there is such a difference between primary retention and secondary retention. It is because there is a problem here, is that if we said there is a secondary retention and then it's based on the primary retention, and then we ask what is the primary retention based on, and then we come into infinite regression without getting out of that. So it is for this reason that Derrida refused to make such a difference, because Husserl has already this huge problem with accounting the origin of consciousness, for example. So Derrida's Aki writing becomes the default by refusing the orders of retention and potential, on this one hand by parrying the danger of infinite regress, while on the other hand seeming to provide an ontological ground for conviction of the phenomenology of time consciousness. For his part, Werner Stigler is strongly influenced by Husserl's phenomenology of time consciousness, but he adds to it what Derrida calls supplement, and what he himself called tertiary retention. Arguing that Husserl's model of time consciousness largely excluded the role of tertiary retention, Stigler equates tertiary retention with what Husserl calls image consciousness, which is a kind of experience we have by looking at a sculpture, a painting, watching television, and so on. The role of physical image object remains ambiguous in Husserl's models of time as a model of time consciousness, and Stigler attempts to show that both retention and potential in fact depend upon the relation to such objects, without which they will not function. Stigler, following the paleontologist Antoine Vargon, that shows that it is crucial to recognize that a representation such a painting is also an exteriorized memory, because this third memory. So if we, for example, before we, in our example about the melody, that we have the primary retention, the primary potential, and then tomorrow when I remember it, and then I also anticipate that we have the secondary and secondary retention and potential. There is a tertiary retention, that is, for example, a CD, a recording, that our consciousness and memories of such an object. So an archive is one such form of exteriorized memory organized precisely in order to function as a supplement to the retention of finitude of humans and traces. In a way, the Stigler resolved the problem of infinite regress is by proposing a default of origin, a necessary default as the limit of such infinite regress. But maybe we come back to this during the discussion. Stigler's mantra with Derrida can be seen as an effort to shift from the transcendental or the quasi transcendental to an imminent historical analysis of technology, inspired both by Le Bargeron and Gilles Simondon. Despite the crucial role played by the supplements in Derrida's work, Stigler reproaches Derrida, the philosopher of deconstruction, of being unconcerned with the history of supplement. So this is the critique of Stigler against Derrida by saying that Derrida ignores the history of supplement. The concept of tertiary retention, on the contrary, allows Stigler to develop a political economy based on the evolution of tertiary retention, that is, on the way that tertiary retention systematically engages with primary and secondary retention and potential. As Stigler wrote, I quote, "I have tried to show that primary retention is always a primary selection, and that this selection is always brought up in function of secondary retentions that anticipates the primary retention in the form of secondary potentials, with the primary potentials being carried by the temporary object that supports the phenomenon and that as such filtered. Furthermore, and above all, I have attempted to show that the conditions under which secondary retentions perforate primary retention, which are thus primary selections, are overdetermined by the phatical and the prosthetic conditions under which the noun can have access to its already there, that is past and secondary, namely through the artifacts in which what I call tertiary retention consists." Now the archive as tertiary retention conditions the selection of potentials. Of primary and secondary potentials, which is, properly speaking, the fabric of experience. Stigler's deconstruction of Husserl, among other thinkers like Kant, Immanuel Kant, and Heidegger, not only deconstructs traditional metaphysics, but also proposes a future of the archive, whose modality can be analyzed according to the historical similarity of technological development. Now the question that I pose in on the existence of digital object is this: if the historical analysis of tertiary retention is not only possible but necessary, would this also apply to the question of potential? This is a tertiary potential, and what does this imply to the thinking? This, on the one hand, this philosophical tradition, and on the other hand, the political question associated with it. Now this question holds the key to developing an understanding of the role of the digital in the concept of the archive, and it is evident and obvious that the rampant dissemination of archivers and production of digital documents, traces, has produced tertiary retention at every scale and in every domain. But what we lack, however, is an analysis of tertiary potential, and in Stigler's own treatment, the question of potential is very much limited to human processes. It is for this reason that we must approach the question of potential from a new direction, not only because the later work of Husserl gave a more prominent role to potential, but also, as we will see, because tertiary potential forms a necessary complement to tertiary retention. So we come to the last part. Tertiary retention and the computational role. In his 1905 course, the relationship between retention and potential was not fully elaborated. and it is cause of Husserl. And in fact, only a few pages were dedicated to the question of potential. In the Galois manuscript and the so-called C manuscript, Husserl provides a rather integrated model of the relationship between intention and potential. In these different versions, Husserl's focus and approach noticeably shift. However, this is not our main concern here. Rather, our interest is in constructing a general understanding of the way intention and potential function in Husserl's model. Potential is a key element that distinguishes Husserl from his teacher, Franz Brentano. Brentano's model has two main elements, namely ordinary sensations of the now moment and, second, representations of the past. While the former, that is to say the ordinary sensations, is real, and the latter, that is to say representation of the past, is unreal, because we can never have direct experience of the past, is already wrong. We can see this in the figure that I show here. Every past now is represented below the flash of consciousness. For example, a point C, if you look at point C here, where the present sensation takes place, and A and B have already become the represented past. That is to say, in Brentano's model of consciousness, the question of potential is almost non-existent. The other main difference between Husserl and Brentano, which is also central to Husserl's triple intentionality model, is that for Brentano, what is perceived is actual, a correspondence between the real and the mental content. While for Husserl, the psychical present is not an instantaneous moment, but a temporal extension. Such an extension, or more precisely, individuation consists of multiple successive phases mediated by the intervening of retention, potential, of retention primary, presentation, and potential. Husserl, unlike Brentano, intends to inquire into this time of consciousness, the individuation of consciousness for which time is its principle. While Husserl effectively adopts some elements taken from Brentano, for example, consciousness as continuous flux. He at the same time elaborates his own model of triple intentionality, so that we can also say here. This is a graph made by Husserl himself. The clearest explanation of the relation between retention and potential is to be found in Article 1 and 2 of the Daniel manuscript. There, the relation between the two, which was only loosely articulated in 1905, was further elaborated. And greater prominence is given to the role of potential, as some commentators have noted. Husserl proposed what he called a primary or original process, and show how potential can be understood from within retention and retention from within potential. I want to emphasize here. Potential within retention and retention within potential. A complex model for which the dynamic modification of both are explained. So he is helpful to refer to his own diagram. So what Husserl was trying to say is that, for example, if you look at this diagram, every primal present is an intentional act that is accompanied by both retention and potential. And we imagine a series of coming events from E1 to E4 here, from E1 to E4 events. And let's take the E2 as the noun. At the moment that E1 is added to retention, it consequently modifies the potential E.3, if you look at the image there. And in the next now of E3, we see that both E1 and E2 are retained as E1.3 and E2.3. The next coming potential is also modified in accordance with the modification of retention, as Husserl says, I quote, "When new core data arises, the old one does not simply become potential, the potential consciousness also grows, The Act complies with the new original data and correspondingly produces itself as then. It is in this sense that we can understand that retention contains the forthcoming potential, while it is also true that there is a retention inside potential, because the consciousness of every potential is not a momentary event, but rather part of an ongoing stream, so that potential in this way resembles secondary retention, except that it is directed towards the future. So at this point, it may be worth emphasizing that there is a functional difference between potential and retention, and that potential is not purely a product of retention, but it definitely relies on later. As many people have noticed that in paragraph 18 of Husserl 11, Husserl proposes an intrinsic difference between retention and potential. Directedness belongs intrinsically to potential. This kind of directedness refers to here, does not belong to the active act of the ego, but is rather a passive directedness in which the ego does not actively anticipate. In this session entitled Description of the Possible Types of Empty Representation, the word empty representation refers to the moment of the primary impression of the stream of consciousness, from where consciousness is continuously constituted. Husserl proposes that even when both potential and retention are empty representations, an immeasurable difference must still remain between them. Firstly, retention lacks directedness, since it does nothing but push back to the past, whereas potential continuously directs attention. Secondly, Husserl reproaches Brentano for seeing the lawful connection between retention and impression as an original association, also proposing instead that association only takes place in potential. Passive directedness seems to be fundamental because it also directs active directedness, meaning that it is already a selection. So I will draw a confrontation. In other words, that potential cannot be reduced to either primary or secondary retention. Otherwise, there will be no difference. Rather, it is the demarcation between passivity and activity whose dynamics is fundamental to Husserl's transcendental phenomenology. If we further consider the dynamic between passive and active directedness against the backdrop of the history of tertiary retention, we can see that such an evolution of tertiary retention entails at the same time an evolution of potential, which can neither be content within some human subject of consciousness, nor reduced to any retention. This is what I call explain as tertiary potential. And it is true that such a tertiary potential depends on the support of tertiary retention. For example, if we talk about debt, so which is at the same time retention and potential, because debt is not purely retentional. Since it also anticipates and commands a return, you have to return to your debt. In all the existence of digital object, I try to approach the question of tertiary retention according to what I call computational hermeneutics or recursivity. And here I would like to, at the very beginning, I made this reference to Bayesian about thinking is always a recursive process. But I try to, I think it's necessary to not to compare the mechanical and the organism, trying to see that if we can realize a machine which resembles the mind, but rather to think of the relation between the machine and the mind. And what would be these relations, or how can you position the mind in the machine? So here are the two key points that I want to mention here. Is firstly, this kind of tertiary potential, which is that we can see in digital technology and algorithm cannot be explained merely in terms of the anticipation of the subject, but rather requires analysis of the forms of anticipation made possible by algorithm, for example, different systems of recommendation or applications of machine learning. Secondly, through this shift, tertiary potential becomes increasingly active to the point of displacing or marginalizing active directness. These two aspects of tertiary potential are not reducible to retentional functions, but are on the contrary characterized by their directness to the future. So we will now come back to the question of digital technology and the political question of the archive, and what will archives become in the coming decades if such a future is imaginable at all. Derrida poses a similar question in Archive Fever regarding the psychoanalytic archive under the digital condition. Derrida asked if the past will exist without the archive, immediately replying, no, the technical structure of the archiving archive also determines the structure of the archivable content, even in its very coming into existence and in its relationship to the future. The archivalization produces as much as it recalls the events. This is also our political experience of the so-called new media. Derrida emphasized email, but why after all email? Derrida states that email, I quote, even more than fax, is on the way to transforming the entire public and the private space of humanity, and first of all, the limit between the private and the secret, and the public, or the phenomenal, as a quotation. At this point, it may be relevant to recall that Bernard Peters, Derrida's biography, noted that Derrida was himself afraid of using email. Hence, Derrida himself also experienced this earthquake, a word used by Derrida himself to describe the earthquake of archiving. Everything sent by email is recorded. But what would Derrida say if he had lived until our current age and witnessed the proliferation of social media, which has only a few years later greatly analyzed the centrality of emails as means of communicating and archiving? The archive of the future is the full realization of the tertiary potential as well as the accomplishment of the archival metaphysics. This doesn't mean that there will no longer be any perception and fantasy, but rather that they are submitted to selection, which is the function of the tertiary potential. The archive of the future is the automatic future in which our selection will be, to a large extent, if not completely, predefined according to a specific schema and index. And this would be the case if we think about the smart objects, smart home, and smart city that we are talking about today, and how it relates to what David raised at the very beginning, in related to the last postscript on the societies of control. And one of the examples that was already raised, given by many computer scientists in the 1990s, is that what about after work, and when you arrive at home, there is already a coffee made for you. Coffee has already anticipated your arrival. And this is more and more the case if we think about the process of smartification. But I conclude by saying that the industrialization of memory, the industrialization of data, become the forefront and the very mechanism of all other forms of industrialization. And the exploitation of data seems no longer to operate simply on the basis of an Abwehrkult or Nachteiligkeit, a deferred action, which would be to remain within an ontological paradigm belonging to the 20th century, the construction with a foreign impression. All the technological epoch has created a new temporal structure, one that aims straight ahead, but does not. Not yet. And what I have tried to to do GIS to suggest that a new temple that we have to conceive a new temple structure which allow us to analyze the cycle of time consciousness and to understand the politics of time and the technological condition. The detour for the 20th century phenomenology is to show that how this constitutes a new philosophical and political question and has yet to be illuminated. But it's very technical, so I thank you very much for your patience and your attention. Thank you.
Do you want to take your own questions?
Yeah, yeah, if you have questions.
Thank you very much for your talk. I really appreciate the depth of the debate about also the model of the pretension and retention mechanisms. Just to enter that kind of zone is very rare. So thank you for that. I don't know if everyone followed, but it's quite key. Seems to be quite key to your argument as to how, in a way, you are moving beyond phenomenological modes of retention and retention, extending it onto, you know, this kind of more general mode of thinking that doesn't thinking vis-a-vis, you know, the temporality of the thinking. So obviously, what we are really talking about is a mnemotechnic and how. You adapt from Stigler this kind of understanding of potential retention in terms of exteriorization of thinking, exteriorization of time, and a mode of memory that is productive. That, of course, is already in Derrida, we find it in Deleuze as well. But then, what it seems to me, I'm not sure, but it seems to me what you are pointing out is that there is some kind of mnemotechnic of the digital that doesn't belong, as you said, to the kind of early 20th century technology of writing and relying on alphabet, especially, so the model discretization of the word, but it's relying on a model that I would call an alien mode of discretization of the word that we are not able to read. You know, a la Kittler, you know, say that, you know, we are writing things that we don't read, we don't have to read what we're writing. So within this frame, how does this politics of time, you know, this kind of hermeneutics that computation allows, becomes another kind of opens up another kind of time of thinking that is almost not prescribed but anticipated, you know, or kind of almost from the perspective of the machine.
So thank you very much for this question because it allows me to clarify many things. So what I'm trying to suggest here is to move away from tool approach to approaches of understanding technology. One is to say that all forms of technologies are forms of writing. I think, of course, they are forms of writing, but actually we have to move beyond that. But the second approach that I want to distance from and want to criticize is that recently that there have been seems to a lot of debates and rejection of technology and based that there's a comparison between technology or computation and the mind. So we say, yeah, the mind can function as a human, sorry, the machine can function as a human mind. And there's an equivalence between these two, because AI at the very beginning was a simulation of the mind. So for those who criticize AI, we say, yeah, but it can never become the mind. You know? But then for those who for AI, we say, yeah, that one day we are going to achieve that. So what I want to get away from this instead of looking into the question of simulation and equivalence, but what we should think about the relation between machines and the mind, and in what way can we really construct an ecology of the mind. And I have chosen to talk about this subject because at the very beginning of the description from Denver, we mentioned about Basin and Basin's ecology of the mind. And myself, I have a particular reading of what Basin means by ecology of the mind. And the issue is the following, is that all from the just epistemology for Basin means precisely how do we know, how to know something. And how not to know something is not that the subject trying to grasp the object, but rather it involves what he calls recursive epistemology. And this is a term that Basin has coined in his later writing. Sometimes he said recursive epistemology or epistemology of recursiveness. And what does he mean by this is that knowing is always recursive, but not simply within a single grasp of the mind. So, for example, if there is a known subject and then an object to know, which is as opposition, recursive thinking is to move beyond that, to move up one level and then to comprehend it. But of course then you have to move up and up and again, so you enter into a recursive model. And that is what I understand as the ecology of mind, and especially in his late book, Mind and Nature, which is actually a strange book because it seems to me it's a book about that shows to me that Basin is a fundamentally idealist, because he's trying to find identity between mind and nature by thinking that the mind thinking is actually like nature, it's recursive. But what I'm trying to hear is to take the question of recursion much further, to think of the that if we understand the human machine relation, and if that machine has the that actually we have to situate thinking within such a recursive process of machines as well. So then there is no then that's why I said we enter into a computational hermeneutics, and it's where we have to identify the political questions. Here is the question of history potential that seems to me is it has not been addressed enough. Because when we talk about automation, we always think about a mechanical automation, but we really talk about the automation which is actually a determination of the future. And this is the question of future that become, in general, become for me a key political question. I don't know if it's clear.
Yes.
Yes. I think that was a question.
I think it's most immediately related to the question of externalization, but not quite encompassed by that. And this question of the political. I was curious how, from this, we might think about like categories such as like accumulation and localization, and I think especially questions of like what would distribution look like as a sort of either as a political category or more abstractly scientific category in light of this kind of framework that you
I don't think that I have clearly understood your question. You mean that what would be the meaning of or what would be what does it mean by distribution in the ecology that I have framework that I proposed? Or
I mean, maybe it could just be if this is the kind of structure of the temporal now, and you're asking this question about the sort of qualitative like automation in terms of the production of a feature, like how would you understand something like what accumulation is?
Let's say it this way. Before we think that the accumulation of the traces through writing and through recording and so on and so forth, these are kind of passive records, and then which is the supplement for us to activate our experience of the past. So this was the common way of understanding the accumulation of traces, which enhance our remembering, which allows to even to anticipate. But if we look into the whole, if we look into the development of digital technology, and then especially with digital automation that we have seen in the past, in the past decades, these traces are no longer simply traces. You know, they are not something that are genius, they are making to be discovered. But there is I was trying to suggest that in every retentional technology, there is always implies a tertiary potential. And this question becomes significant only when with digital automation. And it becomes so important now that we cannot ignore it. We have to put it at the center of the, as a political question. Especially now when we are talking about smart objects, we are talking about smart homes and smart cities. And if there is a systematic of determination, it's from there. Because planning, for example, planning is a tertiary potential.
So my question comes from something that eludes me both in this talk and also in the book. And so let me just narrate it. It really has to do with the politics of algorithms. So algorithms, we can narrate the history of algorithms as, for example, Martin Davis does, as coming out of a Leibnizian dream. And Leibniz's, one of his dreams was really that we could do away with argumentation, we could do away with politics, and replace it with calculation. And we see that, the trace of that sort of dream, according to historians of computation like Martin Davis, into the 19th, into the 20th century. So by the middle of the 1930s, we have at least four ways of defining algorithms. We have Turing machines. We've got Alonzo Church's lambda calculus. We've got Emil Post's production systems. And then we've got what you were talking about here, which is usually associated with Gödel, recursive function theory. So different ways of defining an algorithm, defining a calculation, and so forth. But it's been done very much. I mean, this work was very much to pushes politics to the edge. In fact, pushes meaning to the edge. And you've got what to me is a very intriguing possibility here, both in the book and your talk, where you're coupling this, what I think is almost studiously apolitical discourse around algorithm with something that's quite contrary to, which is the Husserlian phenomenology, or however we want to trace that out, with your term, the tertiary pretension. So in the book, you assert that we can talk about this as recursive, and in fact you also have a cybernetics discourse in there too. You talk about the structural coupling of Varela and Mandarana. But I just, what eludes me is how this goes together. Because if it can be put together, then we have a solution to what is the politics of the algorithm. But if it, but I don't see how it goes together. I just don't see where the recursion goes together with this marvelous new term that you've come up with.
Well, I think we're not saying it this way, because I think it is also related to the talk of David, this new what is an organism. Actually, this is the book I'm writing and I'm finishing, the question of organism. And how I understand the relation between recursivity and the organism here. Now here, the key point is here, the key point is Kant, critique of Kant. And in the second book of the critique of judgment, in paragraph 64 and 65, Kant asks the question, what is an organism? What is a tree? But a tree is reproduces itself. The tree reproduces itself as an individual and as a genre. And the second is that there is a kind of relation between part and the whole. So these are, for me, temporal and spatial relations that we use to define what is an organism. And this process of kind of self-reproduction as if there is a teleology, there is a natural end of nature, is very important to define organism. But it is also for me the question of recursivity. It's for me the question of recursivity, and I believe I'd like to demonstrate this, that this is the question that we can find in Schelling and in Hegel, the philosophy of nature, the question of recursivity, how organism can be formally understood as recursivity, for example. So the question of recursivity for me is a central question, and this I think that you are right that in the early 20th century we observe something which is very significant, significantly different from what Descartes, from Descartes' mechanization. Simondon calls it two technical mentalities. First mentality, Cartesian mechanism. You have one cause-effect. It's a linear chain. Or you have what he called a new technical mentality, which is, he used the example of Vienna, the feedback. He used feedback to describe the second technical mentality, and which he translated into French with different words like ritual action, like recurrent causality. But so it is no longer a kind of linear causality, but like a recursive movement that comes back to itself in order to know itself. So what I'm trying to say is that the way we understand machine has significantly shifted, and this is shared by different movement or different thought emerged in the early 20th century with computation, for example, where you said Turing and Gödel. But of course, Gödel has said that these are equivalent in the lambda calculus and the Turing machine and the general recursive function, they're equivalent. And with cybernetics, with automata theory. What is the significance here is that there is also a new mode of organization, a new mode of organization that has emerged. And this mode of this organization has surpassed the opposition between, on the one hand, mechanism and vitalism. Because vitalism, if you explain an organism according to vitalism, then the rejection would be that you want to explain it with a mysterious force. But if you explain it with organization, you get out of the opposition between vitalism and mechanism. something that was, I think it was a very significant moment in that we still have to further analyze in the in the first half of the 20th century. So that is why I try to when I said about coupling, I was trying to show that if the coupling of Varela and Maturana is still based on the on the model of organism, that in which the that is to say a living being and its environment. Today we have to further analyze what is happening to the environment and how this living being, what is organism, is position or is yes, it's a position in the whole recursive organization has to be reconsidered and to rethought. And this is the political question that I think we have to, and also metaphysical question as well that we have to further reflect on. I don't know if this makes sense to you. No.
We can talk more on the panel too. I was just going to say we should probably be quick on a couple of questions and then take our break. And we can follow up with more discussion on the panel. So maybe take one or two quick questions and we should take our coffee.
Question?
Okay. Just as students, so this comes a very childish question that what do you think about this very popular idea of words of curation? What do you think about that very popular words, the idea of curation, and compare with the Derrida's deconstruction? Do you think it's this conflict? And also, what is the picture in your mind that these two concepts would impact the new media, especially social media?
Curation in the way of curating an exhibition.
It's very popular. Say, curation, curated.
Curation and
concept and this deconstruction. Do you think it's conflict?
I don't really understand the question. I just cannot relate how these are related. Maybe if you, either you elaborate on the question or you.
Maybe we can take it.
You did mention selection a lot, and about retention and protection.
So right. Nice. Oh, right. Okay, so thank you very much. That's a key to help me to relate this together. No, I think that the question of selection, of course, is the way to show that we have to move from a kind of human centrism is to say, for example, if we refer to Stigler, is that if the tertiary retention is, for example, a computer or artificial memory, is the condition of selection, right? Because it is by listening to the MP3 that you remember a song that you have heard 2 years ago, for example. So there is that it is the tertiary memory is the condition of selection, for example. That's clear. But when that in this interpretation. Is still the question of retention is still kind of passive in a way. And I try to show that actually in Husserl, if you look in the later work of Husserl, it's clear to show that we can find that there is the retention in potential and potential in retention. And if we really want to look into the history of the history of the supplement, we also have to look into this, the mechanism or the role of the potential in retention, for example. And what we can see here is that the selection is no longer that the ego or either me who look at the material and then I select, but something is already selected. So this is a kind of for me, I will say that this is a kind of general phenomenon of algorithmic thinking. So the things are rather anticipated, this eventually will all be removed. We sort of can look into the computational paradigm that we have today. So we will...
Great, that's a good... Yeah, we'll take a break for coffee and come back just around 4. So thanks so much. Thank you.